All right. So we are here. Like normal, we're going to kind of wait a couple minutes, see that everybody came back from the break. All right. Say hi in the chat if you're here. We've got Dominic, Natalia, Amy, Bethany, Kyle, Oregon Mesa admin, Amy, let's see. Any other people, new people joined? Amy, you are getting in early. Hey, Frankie. Let's see. Let's see. Remember, you can use the emojis. Emojis in the bottom. Okay. All right, so it's 4:26, so we'll get started. Everybody, welcome to our second session of the day. I'm gonna pull up our presentation. So another OMSI STEM Sparks. This session is about escaping quarantine, how to design for life with COVID-19, okay? So we're gonna have a really fun session today. We've got, of course, Ebeth, who's always fantastic. And we've got Mike, who is our subject matter expert today. Mike is here. He is a graduate student from Portland State University. And I think that you guys should know the community guidelines by now. If you don't, ask a friend in the chat. And I'm gonna let Mike kick it off with his self-introduction. So me and Ebeth might pop off camera for a bit while he does that.
Hello, hi everybody. My name is Mike. And just as Bianca said, I am currently a student at Portland State University. I'm studying computer science and I'm doing a master's in the subject matter. But before that, I actually had a degree in fine arts like a very long time ago. And through my experience of working in science museums, I also worked with Ebeth at OMSI. I learned that I wanted to get into science and I got some experience with computer science working at OMSI. So I went to PSU and they were like, hey, yeah, you could do another degree. You can do computer science. So I took on that task and here I am. In addition to that, I've also have created a YouTube channel where I make songs about science, like everything from dinosaurs to computer science, really. Does anyone have any questions about computer science or what's grad school like? Or
did you want to play your video, Mike?
Oh, right. I have a video. If anyone here is a fan of 21 Savage, you might recognize the tune in the background. It's a short video to give you a taste of some of the stuff that I do. Here we go. It might play like right away. I might have to rewind it. Let's try this.
Into computer science, upper division. Yo, how many classes you got? Straight up. How many notes you got? Straight up. How many projects you got? Straight up. How much homework you got? A lot. How much code you got? A lot. Break it into units. A block. How many times did you segfault access memory you ain't using? A lot. Semicolon goes missing. A lot. Member access operator. A dot. Root pointer is null. You stop. Floating point operations. A flop. How many errors you got? A lot. How many memory leaks? A lot. How many infinity loops? A lot. How much help did you need? A lot. How many times did you pass? A lot. How many times did you fail? A lot. How much anxiety did you go through, but still dodging them L's?
Yeah. So that was a quick parody that I did of 21 Savage a lot, because at some point I was like, wow, going from fine arts to computer science is a whole like different game in terms of workload and exams and the questions that you get. And I was like, wow, computer science is a lot. all of this homework is a lot. And everything in that song is based on true stories. Although it was a quick shot of my exams, those were actual exams that I've passed and actual exams that I failed. And it's also, yeah, it's also anxiety inducing with the amount of deadlines and everything. So that was just a song for all the fellow students and or future students to also let them know that it's okay if you don't do well on a test, that there's always chances to do better.
Okay, thanks, Mike. I will drop you guys the link to Mike's YouTube channel. However, I won't do that now because I need you guys to pay attention here. So Mike, we have one question in the Q&A already. How long have you been in school? Like, and you can talk about like your art degree and then now being a graduate student in computer science.
Yeah. So my first round of college was actually a really strange time for me. I did really well in high school. But when I took the SATs, I didn't do so well in math. And I also didn't really know what I wanted to do in college. It just seemed like my parents are all of a sudden pushing me to take these classes and move away. All I wanted to do was skate. I was really good at rollerblading and like grinding rails and stuff. So I thought that was my future. I wanted that to be my future. But I went to the University of Maryland for 2 years. And then I decided to come back to New York because I grew up in New York and I did the rest of my fine arts degree there. But I really took my time. I like stopped taking classes for a while. I got a job. And then I thought, well, I have a job now, so why do I have to go to school? But then I quickly learned that when you have a degree, it opens up possibilities because the job that I was working at was at the New York Hall of Science. It was an entry-level position of just explaining science to people as they come into the museum. But my boss said, hey, if you had your degree, I would hire you full time. And so that added some motivation for me to finally finish my degree. So it took me like 6-7 years to do my first degree because I took my time. There was a term, I took like 2 terms off. And then after that, I worked for like an additional 10 years at different museums. So I was at the New York Hall of Science doing science. I was at the Museum of the Moving Image, like talking to people about film and television, like ask me stuff about Jurassic Park. It's an amazing movie. And then I worked at OMSI, and during that time, I was also making videos like the one that you just saw. So that got me really interested in science. And when I was working at OMSI, I had also realized like I could be making more money. Like it's pretty hard to live by myself and pay rent and pay for a car and all this. So I decided that I should like one, I wanted to get back into science. Two, I wanted to have a career where if I wanted to like fly around the world for no reason, I mean, we can't do that now for obvious reasons, but that I could do it without having to look into my bank account. So I wanted a career that was a bit more lucrative, but still involved science. So I chose computer science at Portland State, and I started that 3 years ago. And in about a year, I'll have finished with my master's. So it's been a long journey and not the typical journey of like, oh, I went to school and then I went to school again and now I have a job. For me, it was I went to school, high school, then I went to college and it was like, oh, that's kind of weird. So I stopped, then I went back, then I stopped. And then 10 years later, I decided to do it again. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Let's see, who have we got another question from in the chat? All right, Elizabeth asks, what drew you to computer science?
So I decided that I wouldn't make this like the same choices that I made the first time when I was in high school. That was a different time of my life. My brain was literally shaped different then. I picked fine arts on a whim. I was like, well, I got to pick something. I'll do fine arts. I just happen to have like a little bit of experience with Photoshop. So that's what I'll do. But this time around, there's a lot of information on the internet now, but you also have to be careful with some of the information. But there's a lot of trustworthy information out there. And I was looking at what degrees, like what are the average salaries based on the degree that you achieve? And computer science was up there. So was mechanical engineering. That was actually like one of my first choices. I was like, oh, I'll be Mike, the mechanical engineer, like MM. But then I took a class and it was pretty tough. I mean, I understood the material, but the way they taught it just didn't work with my style. And when I took the computer science class, one, I saw that like as a, like with a bachelor's in computer science, you could make like up to $100,000 a year. What? Sign me up. what was the other part? Money. That one of the main motivations is not to be broke, because eventually you're gonna have to pay for your own stuff when you get older, and you don't want to be in a situation where not having money is a problem. So I figured that with computer science, I would be able to like lift myself up in terms of finances and have a different quality of life. And additionally, with computer science, there's a bit more flexibility in terms of possibly starting my own company, being an entrepreneur, seeing potential. I could see that, for example, Zoom and video chats aren't perfect, and I have some understanding now of how it works and how it could be changed. So it kind of gave me a little bit of a superpower, at least in terms of computers and programming, and also in the way of like problem solving and thinking. It's like very different for computer science. And so I decided to do that. It was also, there was one other thing. I had it in my mind and then I forgot what it was. There was something else about computer science that made me choose it. It's multifactorial. There's more than one reason why I chose it. It was like money, entrepreneurial opportunities. Oh, right. I had took students from OMSI on a trip to AWS Elemental. They're the folks that work on like video compression and streaming, and they're located in downtown Portland. And the trip was for the students. Like, it was absolutely for them. But I couldn't help as a chaperone to just ask so many questions and be amazed by everything that I saw. And one of the things that they said was that there's a huge demand for software engineers. And some engineers, during their job interview, they actually kind of flip the script a little bit. And they say, you know what? Instead of this $100,000 salary, I want $80,000. And I'm only going to work 4 days a week. And you're going to give me full benefits. And I was blown away by that. Like, what? I want to have a 3-day weekend every weekend. That would be amazing. That'd be like, Bianca, you would want that. Ebeth, you would want that. Yeah. Like 3-day weekend. Come on. So I was like, wow, computer science opens doors. Also, that company, like, they have breakfast, like they have like cereal, like on tap.
Yeah.
Like, you there, don't are, lunch.
There are a lot of tech companies that have, you know, perks like snacks, you know, yeah. And nice snacks too, right?
So like, you never have to buy lunch again.
Yes. So let's see, before we get to the rest of the questions, we did want to ask you, Mike, you know, about your work with Invention Bootcamp, which is a summer program that MESA actually collaborates with in order to, you know, recruit high school students. And then they actually do human-centered design projects with Invention Bootcamp. So tell us about your experience with Invention Bootcamp. What does that look like? And like the, how do you use your computer science skills at Invention Bootcamp?
Yeah, shout out to Invention Bootcamp. It's one of like the most amazing programs ever. The way Invention Bootcamp works is it is a, I forget how many weeks, it's some amount of weeks of like, we have a problem that we're going to solve and you're going to solve it. And you end up learning so much. Essentially, it's like, you just took an intro to mechanical engineering, like at no cost to you with all of the materials. Even when we did it remote, you still had access to materials and equipment to make inventions. So in addition to getting like physical items like circuit boards and wires and Arduinos and laptops on loan, you also get all of this knowledge. You learn how to program, you learn how to build circuits, you learn how to think about design in a way that helps you organize your thoughts and work with a team to create a final thing. And it's amazing. It's a lot of fun. This past summer, our theme, so each camp has a theme. And this past summer, the theme was living in COVID times. And so it gave us, when I say us, I mean like the students and myself, because as a mentor, we're actually like also participating and learning as well. It gave us a chance to really reflect on how our lives were being impacted by COVID-19. And it allowed us to think of ways that we could solve some of those problems. And the students came up with some amazing ideas, and they actually built like prototypes of the items, the inventions that they would make to solve those problems. And so like, for example, one group, they had the idea of like, you know what? Darn, I thought I had a mask like right next to me. I was gonna put the mask on. But the idea of like, when you wear a mask, like, was I smiling just now? Am I frowning? Like, nobody really knows, right? And that's sort of a problem, because looking at people's faces is something that maybe we've taken for granted, being able to read someone's facial expression, like in public. Like if you're going to the grocery store and you say thank you to the cashier or any employee at the store, or you say like, I'm sorry, because you might've like bumped into someone, or, you know, like we kind of read their faces to get some extra information. And we also like to have people read our faces without even thinking about it. So one group, they created their own mask that uses lights to simulate emotions. Like it would be red if you're angry, blue if you were sad. The lights would light up in the shape of a smiley face to show that you were happy, or it would like flash for an emergency. And you would just like press a button to make that happen. So they had an idea. They took some of the skills that they learned from Invention Bootcamp, and they worked together to build that mask. And that mask, it was a little bit of like art, because they had to design something that looked good. It was a little bit of programming, because they had to program the lights to respond to when you press a button. It also involved like mechanical, because, you know, you had a button that you had to press and it had to be hooked up to a circuit. You learn so much in Invention Bootcamp. It's really amazing. And groups made other inventions. I talk about the mask one the most because I was the mentor for that group, so I'm a little bit biased.
That one was a pretty good idea. I saw the final presentations and I was like, wow, that's actually a great idea. All of the ideas are great, and it's great that like the students really thought outside of the box as far as like, you know, what was going on with COVID and what are the problems that we're encountering, not just like at home, but out in our communities.
Right. And not just like, oh, we should come up with a cure to the virus. There are other things that COVID is impacting besides like health, right? Like one group created, they made a way of detecting how many people enter a room as they like walk past a barrier. So that way you could keep track of like how many people are in this grocery store. How many people are, well, it's funny, I keep saying grocery store, I don't know what else is open. But like just those ideas. And one group created something that most people didn't even really think about. And it's something that I think about as a student. They created their own version of a Pomodoro timer. And that the Pomodoro timer is based off of a philosophy of how do you like study effectively. And like a lot of people, including myself, when we study, we kind of just like take our books and we're just like, all right, I'm going to study from 9 to 5. And you just read, 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 and then, you know, lose focus. And then like 5 hours have passed by and I didn't read a single chapter about object-oriented programming. But the idea behind the Pomodoro was to set a time goal, like maybe I'll study for 1 hour. But in that hour, it's you're going to study for 20 minutes and then take a 5 minute break, then study for another 20 minutes, take a 5 minute break. And they created a sort of like a little reminder, an electronic reminder that would light up and do a countdown for your study intervals. And then it would even have messages like, you got this, keep on doing it, you're great, to keep people motivated. And that's like a real problem. And another group made, they made a display for their door to let people know when they're busy, because one of the worst things that happen during a Zoom meeting is for someone to just walk through the door and bug you. But if you have a device there that's like, hey, I'm busy, walk, like come back later, then they won't do that. Like, I mean, I live alone, so I'm not worried about someone walking through the door there. But you know, I don't know about Bianca's situation or Ebeth's situation, but any moment someone could walk in, maybe a little toddler. Right. Not so little anymore.
Well, you know what, Mike, that's a perfect segue into Ebeth's activity, because, you know, what you did with your students in Intervention Bootcamp is similar to what Ebeth is going to kind of walk us through today. So it's designing for life, like getting out, doing things, going to places, communicating with people in an environment where COVID-19 is like this new reality. So I'm going to hand it over to Ebeth.
Yeah. So we, if you've been with us the past couple of days, we've kind of done some online games that were sort of individual, but now we're going to do one all together. Who here is excited for Halloween?
It hasn't come up on our end yet, okay. But it's is it almost.
All right. Y'all see a picture of a pumpkin wearing a mask?
No? I do.
Great.
And then in the chat, I think they're saying, wait, what? Yes.
Okay, great.
Send us, if you guys can see it, say today something.
With the screen share being a little small, so hopefully you see it bigger this time.
Okay.
So Halloween is just around the corner in like, what, a week and a half? But it's going to be really different this year. But I think we can come up with some great ways to design to make it better. So at this point, like, we've all been physically and socially distancing for several months. It might feel like years. We've kind of lost track of time. It doesn't really have a meaning anymore. But it's always great to have something to look forward to. I'm personally really excited about Halloween. I hope other people are excited about Halloween too. It's not even just the candy, although you're gonna think I'm obsessed with candy by the time we're done with this. But like the costumes, getting to see other people in costumes, it's so great. But the big question on everybody's minds is, how can we do this? How can we do anything Halloween related and still keep ourselves safe? So we're gonna do a choose our own adventure that will result in us designing something to make Halloween still fun, but also safe. So we're gonna use the poll function here. And
there's one in the queue.
There's one, great. So Halloween is coming. We're gonna ask you to take a vote. Should we stay at home, option A, or option B, go out with friends? So you're gonna see that poll pop up. And choose which one you want to do. We'll give folks a good minute or two here because I know there's a lag. All right. Ooh, it's flip-flopping.
Votes are coming in.
It's flip-flopping. Oh, yeah. All right. It looks like it's, All right, it looks like it's settled down. So, the drama here.
We're still waiting for like a couple to come in.
After Halloween. So it looks like the top choice is choice A. We're going to stay at home. Probably a safe choice, given what we know about how COVID spreads and how it spreads with people. And, you know, it's Oregon. It's probably going to be raining outside anyway. So we're going to stay home, but we're still going to have some fun. So what are we going to do? Are we going to give candy to people who might be trick-or-treating? Or are you just going to wait until your siblings come home with candy? So we're going to do a poll again. You can choose option A if you want to give out candy, or option B if you just want to wait until, if you don't have sisters or brothers, pretend that you have younger sisters and brothers, wait until they come home and eat their candy. Well, it sounds like somebody's eating some candy right now.
It's me. But I was laughing at most people are choosing B. So you guys are lazy Halloweeners.
Lazy or just efficient? It looks like option B here is winning. 69% of people think that we should wait until any younger siblings come home and eat their candy. Plus, look at this adorable pumpkin eating candy. That baby's way too young to be eating candy, FYI. But
I think that was everybody. So,
all right. So, of course, it's way easier to let them do the work, right? But them getting candy and having candy still requires some safety measures, because you're sending your siblings out in the world to get the candy. So should you design something to protect them and keep them safe while they're getting candy? That's option A. Or should you figure out a way to sanitize the candy so that it's safe to touch and unwrap, and most importantly, to eat? So option A, if you want to design something to keep your siblings safe, or option B, if you want to design something to make sure that the candy is safe. All right. Oh, this one's a little closer. Oh, a couple more rolling in. Oh, look at that. Oh, man. Anybody else? It's practically split down the middle. I'm glad we have an odd number of people.
I think that's everybody. So, cool.
All right.
It is A.
We're going to choose to protect them. So our design challenge is to design a Halloween costume that incorporates good protection for these siblings who you're asking to go out and get candy so that you can eat it. So your challenge is to design a costume that incorporates a face mask and gloves so that your sibling can stay safe when they're going door to door, or maybe porch to porch, depending on how people are delivering candy. But remember, as you're designing this costume, that they need to be able to see where they're going so that they can figure out where all the candy is and where the doors are. So, and it should probably also be visible, because y'all are in Oregon. You know how dark it is in the evening, but even if you're going trick-or-treating at like 6 o'clock or 5 o'clock at night, it gets pretty gloomy. So visibility, protection, able to see. So to help us see each other's designs, we are going to use a program called Jamboard. And I'm going to switch my screen again so that we can see this. Oops, oh, great, look at that. Just need to drag it over for you to see it, perfect. So in a moment, we'll put a pop-up for using Jamboard. This is one of Google's products. You may have used it before. If you haven't, I think we'll all be able to use the same Jamboard, because I think we're a small enough group. Yeah. So on this board up at the top here, there's sort of the pages. You are going to choose a page.
Actually, I'll name each person and assign them a number.
Great. Yeah. So you'll be assigned a page. I'm going to assign myself number one just to make it easy. That way you know that that page has been claimed. And on this page is where you can draw your design. Over on the left here, there's like pen options and erasing options. If you even need to like upload images, you can search for things. You need to put a picture in. So we'll give folks maybe like 7 minutes, 5 minutes to design. This will be pretty fast, and then we'll go through and see if what awesome ones there are to share out, see what everybody makes. So Bianca, why don't you go ahead and assign folks?
Yeah, so I am going to call off your names because I have everybody's names pulled up here, and I'm gonna assign a number. So Cassie Harvey, you're gonna get page 2, and you showed them how to change the pages, right?
Yeah, so on the top. Ooh.
So Cassie Harvey, do page 2. Dominic, page 3. Mary Jane, page 4. Kyle, page 5. Bethany, page 6. Amy Pavel, page 7. Elise, page 8. Uriel, page 9. Frankie, page 10. May, page 11. Guadalupe, page 12. Molly, page 13. And Natalia, page 14. And so you guys are going to get that pop-up offer for Jamboard right now. Okay. And you all can go in and design one. So there are a couple of pages after page 14 left. So if some of the MESA staff wants to do page like 15 through 20, they can do that. I'm going to do page 20.
Cool. All right. Let's take like, we'll say 5 minutes until 5:02 to do some designs. And then we'll do a couple of minutes of sharing, and then we'll open it up for questions again at the end. I'll leave my screen on so you can see what I'm thinking. And as a reminder, you're designing a costume that protects a sibling if they're going door to door to get candy, or a friend if you'd rather think of a friend. They can still see, and they can be seen because it's gloomy outside.
Oh, Uriel asked if what if we don't do Halloween? I don't know.
Case, design an outfit for walking around in the evening that allows you to see and be seen, but also keeps you safe with that mask and gloves parameter. An evening outfit, if you will. Oh, I think somebody is also on page 1 and just deleted my bubble. Make sure you're on the right page that Bianca gave you.
Yeah, make sure you're on the right page. I can private message each person and make sure that they're at the right page. So let me see. I'm going to... And do make sure it is appropriate, because if it's not, I'll kick you out.
All right, about one or two more minutes. If you're also not very comfortable with drawing, I forgot to mention there's a text option. You can just like write what you're thinking.
Oh, wow. There's some people who've got some pretty good stuff in here. I'm walking through, looking at these different costumes. Very artistic people. Mike, I just saw your submission. We'll look at it later.
Oops, I got so excited, I lost track of time. I'll do a quick pan through. Bianca, since it sounds like you're looking through, if you have any page ideas, I'll talk about mine first, just to break the ice. My idea for a costume is a bubble. So you can still stay inside your quarantine bubble, but be seen and be safe, because it's a mostly clear bubble that's embedded with UV reactive particles that fluoresce and phosphoresce and reflect light, so that when light shines, it's very visible, but it's still transparent that you can see through it really well. And then I forgot about the part where I said you had to wear gloves and a mask, so I added those on. They're conveniently blue to be like a bubble floating through space. Bianca, any other cool ones we should look at? That's me sounding like mine's cool, but
let me see. Anyone, hey, if anyone wants theirs to be shared, can you raise your hand? Raise your hand in the chat. Mike Wilson said he wants his to be shared. So, Mike, what page is yours on?
I'm on page 18. But also, we got more hands raised, so I could be last if you want.
Yeah, let's do Uriel. You only did it once.
They're like,
okay. Let's do MJ. MJ, what page are you on? Let me see. Mary Jane, aka J. So that was page, I'm looking through my page numbers and I can't find her name.
Four.
I think it may be number,
I see
that one.
Yeah. Oops. Make sure I'm on arrow here. So, oh, just put a pumpkin on your head. Also, an astronaut guy would have a full body suit and just kitchen gloves. Congrats, you are a clown for Halloween. I love it. I would totally wear this, especially that cape. Capes are amazing.
Let's do Uriel's on page 9 next.
I like the Among Us reference.
Oh, speaking of photobombing children, let's see. Uriel says he's got a, there's a book pack or backpack with stuff in case of emergency. Ooh, a hat with lights. Great. Some green gloves and an awesome. Oh, and a belt with cleaning supplies. Yes. And a suit with bright LED lights. Okay. Sorry, thank I was you. Bombed by a dragon.
Thank you, Uriel, for sharing. Let me see. Dominic, Dominic is on page 3.
All right, speaking of which, amazing dragon costume with the eyes visible so a person can totally see out. Great use of an image also here, Dominic. And some cool dragon gloves. Awesome. I love these designs. Thanks for your creativity. How about we bop back over for the last couple minutes we have here to the Q&A and see if there are any lingering questions for Mike. I'm going to turn off my screen share here. Yeah.
And for those of you who's didn't get shared, everyone can kind of like just go through the different pages and take a look at everyone's designs. Thank you all for participating. They're really, really creative.
Yeah.
Okay, so let me see in the Q&A. Q&A, there's a couple of other questions for Mike. Mary Jane asked, do you think that websites using block code like scratchcode.org effectively introduce coding to beginners? Or do you think there's a better way?
You know, everyone has a different learning style. And I think starting with Scratch is great because it gets you thinking beyond code. It like a lot of people think about code as like, oh, I'm going to write, you know, 4i equals, you know, 9 while less than blah, 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 blah. But we need more people, and I say we, like the industry needs more people who can think the way a computer thinks. And the way a lot of Scratch programs are set up, or the way a lot of like, you know, learn how to code sites that use things like Scratch are set up, they're set up in the way to get you thinking like, how do I solve this problem using code? As opposed to like just worrying about like, oh, did I use an equal sign when I meant to use a double equal sign? How do I write the code? It's more about how do I solve the problem? And I think that's great, but everyone has a different learning style. And so for some people that might work, for other people, they may like hands-on programming, like with physical items. I knew that worked for me, like writing like code to make a light turn on was amazing to me because I could see it happen like right then and there. So that worked out a lot for me. So I would say just try out different things and see what works for you. And that's why it's great that there are a lot of different options out there for learning how to code, because everyone thinks differently and there may be something that works better for you than it might for somebody else.
Thank you. Thank you, Mike. I know there are more questions in the Q&A, but we're trying to, you know, make sure we end on time. So we have a couple of handouts for you guys. First one is, here is a link to Mike's YouTube channel. Go there and subscribe.
Oh, yeah, I forgot that picture is there.
Yes, it is. So go to Mike's YouTube channel, subscribe. Mike, do you, I know someone else dropped your Instagram in the chat, which is, it's the same thing at Mike Likes Science, right?
Yes. Yep.
Yes.
Yeah.
So if you guys want to ask Mike more questions, go to at Mike Likes Science. Okay. And as always, go ahead and complete that feedback form. All right. And then you all have another 10 minutes until our last session of the day. It starts at 5:20 p.m. So, you know, come back here, join us again. Thank you, Mike, for being our featured speaker today. And thank you, Ebeth, as always. Yeah. We're really excited to have you here. So.
Fun fact, I met Ebeth way before I worked at OMSI, way before I moved to Oregon, because she came to the New York Hall of Science to train people on an exhibit, and I just happened to be there.
Yeah, and I have no memory of that happening, but I'm glad that it did.
Yeah. So it's great. It's great to see, you know, different scientists, creators, artists, you know, creating cool things across the world and reconnecting, especially, you know, right here in Oregon. Moving on. All right. All right, guys, I'm going to end the session. Thanks again to Mike Wilson at Mike Likes Science. Go check him out. Subscribe to his YouTube channel. Share it with your friends. And complete those feedback forms. And I'll see you guys in like 9 minutes now. All right. Thanks again, Ebeth. See you tomorrow. Really gonna end it now. Okay. See y'all later.